So maybe the two of you who are in the furthest corner might want to sit here, because I'm only going to use this whiteboard. It's the only thing that fits in the camera. And those things are just supporting. Just try not to touch the tripod, and then it will be better for you also. Because this is just for support, and it's going to be on the web anyway. So it's just six pictures. And
it's in the picture.
How much?
Just a bit. Okay, now it's, no, it works. Okay.
No, come on. No, it's it. No, you're gonna.
Okay, now it works.
Is it comfortable? Come on. Let's see how much of your IC.
That's okay.
Let me see how much. Because we can push this a little bit up, no?
Up?
Yes, because I can push the whiteboard up. It's not a problem. Just like you push the camera like at this height, then he will not show up. Okay, and then you are more sit comfortably. Just see, that's fine. No problem. Okay. So sorry for the technological inconveniences. These lectures are going to be recorded because there are many people coming in and going out for conferences and so on. And we start today, so that means that we have to do a little bit of recap and go back over the things of the last day. For those of you who are not here, or for those of you who are here, just remind you that there is this web page where I'm putting all the notes from the different lecture days, including the few pictures that you're going to see in the projectors. I mean, the projector material is just for, because some pictures are too complicated to be made on the whiteboard. I just project them there, but you can watch them on the PDF afterwards, no problem. So, as I said the other day, we want to reach circuit quantization theory, but I didn't want to do it in a naive way, giving you a set of rules and you want to apply blindly. And we wanted to go through a more or less intuitive theory that could justify, in a sense, where these rules come from. And the things we came up with is a model of quantum fluid of charged particles that behave like bosons and that evolve according to a Schrodinger equation. Where is the eraser? Here. Just to fix notation. Psi plus Q psi. So we have an Schrodinger equation of a charged particle coupled to the electromagnetic field, vector potential, electric potential. Q is some charge we didn't know what whose magnitude would be, and the whole wave function of all the particles that are moving in this fluid, it would be just the product of them. So, in a sense, this is analogous to a Bose-Einstein condensate, as you would find it for atomic physics, for those of you who know atomic physics, but we now allow the particles to have some charge. And we extracted what are the consequences of using this model, London's model, of superfluidity and superconductivity, and we started by assuming, for instance, that, if this is a charge of a particle, then the density of charge would be simply Q times the density of carriers, so how many carriers you have per volume, which we it would be more convenient then to simply, instead of using this picture, just to say that psi represents the whole fluid, and psi of x is normalized with the density of particles. Using this Schrödinger equation and substituting quantities and computing the current probability, I mean, we want to find an equation that is of this form. The derivative of the charge is comes from the divergence of some current. We ended up with the first London equation, which establishes a proportionality between the current and the electric field. Basically, it would be the most relevant part would be of this form. When the velocity of the particles is not too high and there is not a strong magnetic field, basically you would have that whenever you change the current, it generates an electric field, as you would expect from an inductor. We also saw that if you have some superconducting material and you establish some, well, let's print it like this. You establish some magnetic field here. This magnetic field decreases over a distance, which is called the random penetration depth. And actually, this is a function of this constant here. So lambda is of the order of this quantity, where we obtain this from microscopic principles as just something that depends on the properties of the material, so like the charge of the carrier, the effective mass that they have, and the density of carriers in the volume. This is important because at some point this kind of inductance may be the dominant contribution in your circuit. We will see it when we have very thin cables. This is also important because this tells you that a superconductor expels the magnetic field from its inside. And this has consequences because this expelling means that there appear surface currents that compensate this magnetic field, which is an additional effect to the one that you would find with a metal, with charged particles trying to compensate electric fields. So both things are important because when you want to, for instance, solve what would be the field distribution that you have in a superconducting circuit when you establish some potentials or currents, you have to solve the Maxwell equations with the appropriate boundary conditions. And this physics tells you what the boundary conditions are, which are different for a metal and from a superconductor. The next thing we did is that we took this analogy further. We assume that more or less it's very difficult to really change the density of carriers because they have to compensate the number of atoms that they have in a volume. So these are negative particles moving in a crystal of positively charged ions. So this will be more or less constant. But we can allow this guy to change in time and space. And when you assume this, you find that the current also can be related to the gradient of the phase. Which is a very important thing. So it's telling you that this wave function has two physical properties, one of which is the density of carriers that can be measured, and another one that cannot be directly measured, which is this phase, but whose gradient is something that can be measured, which is the current of particles. Okay. Any questions so far? Anything that you, from the other day, did not understand and want to clarify a bit better? We're going to go through this again in a minute, because that's something that some of you had the problem to visualize. Okay, so the fact that the current is proportional to the gradient of the phase means that this cannot be just anything. And it has one important property, which is that if you integrate this over a closed circuit, you get, we are going to use. I0. So you get that there is a quantization rule that tells you that this contour integral of the current plus the flux, which is confined within this loop, C can be any loop, directed contour, has to be proportional to the flux quantum, which is a constant that we built from the charge of the carriers. And I told you that this was experimentally measured by having superconducting cylinders, establishing some flux through it, and moving the cylinder in and out of a coil. And when you do that, what the coil does is to measure the variation of the flux inside it. So you have this superconducting ring with a hole, and it goes in and out of a coil, oscillating very rapidly. And this way they could measure how much flux was trapped inside this tube. And well, when the device is very thick, you can assume that the current inside is going to be zero. So you have that the compensation of the magnetic field on the surface plus the confined surface magnetic field that comes from the outside is simply a total flux that is a multiple of this flux quantum. This is very important because we are going to find this again and again when we look at circuits. It's in general, you're going to find that circuits have loops. Like for instance, I wrote this capacitor, inductor circuit, and in principle, there could be flux trapped inside here. In this case, it's not because you have this capacitor which breaks the circuit, but in other cases, there might be. The last relation that we found that was not exact, that we are going to complete today, was that in addition to the current being proportional to the phase itself can be derived from external potentials. So if you substitute this formula in the Schrödinger equation and compute the time derivative of the phase, you'll find that this has the form, this form, which tells you that the phase depends on time with the electric potential. Because Q is negative, this has this formula. Which tells you that this is basically 2 pi I zero u, so that you can define, well, this is basically that the time derivative of u, or the u theta, is essentially the flux of the circuit, where flux, remember the time derivative of flux is u, divided by the flux quantum, plus some constants that are not relevant for us. So I insist this is approximate. We'll find a more careful derivation today based on Josephson junctions. So now, the other day, some of you asked me, really, how is these things with the phase gradients and currents? And I made a couple of pictures trying to show how this works. No, it takes too long to start. The idea is not going to show on the blackboard, but it's on the internet. The idea is that you can draw phase distributions. And in general, they are going to be very trivial, because what is going to happen is that unless you play tricks, most of the time you're going to find currents that simply cancel each other, no? Simply flow particles in one direction or another one, so on. The most interesting situations are those in which the phase wraps around a point, which would be a kind of a vortex. This is what you see here. This would be a phase that goes like theta. Something like this. It's the angle, a polar angle on a circle. Can you see?
I can.
Yeah, I think you can. No, yes.
Are you going to move out?
No, I'm going to stay here.
Okay.
But you can see it more or less, no? And so the idea is that when you do that and you compute the gradient of this phase, you find that it really wraps around the circle. You have a circular current around this point, something which is called a vortex. Let me see if I can flip page with this. So that would be typical, for instance, the density distribution for a Bose-Einstein condensate in a trap. The Bose-Einstein condensate is like this superfluid, but without charge. It's rotating inside the trap. You have this phase distribution, and because there is a singularity in the phase here, the density has to be zero at that point exactly. And you have this density distribution, which is actually, since stationary, it's actually particles moving around that core. So it's not obvious to see that it's moving, but by releasing the atoms, you can see it. You can have higher quanta of rotation by the same principle. You can have a ring of atoms, and you can establish different phase gradients. It would be 2 pi, 4 pi, and so on. And you find that every time you do that, the current increases, and in some cases, the current is so strong that destabilizes the ring. This is for atoms, okay? So it's something that is very easy to build in the lab, Paul Bisi. It's now feasible, and people do it everywhere. And for a superconductor, we have a little bit more flexibility because we are not confined in a closed space with particles just fixed in that space. We really have currents, we have transport. So we can have more sophisticated configurations. So this would be, for instance, a ring that is attached to a cable. I don't know if you see it very clearly in the screen, but you can probably see it better on the PDF. There is a color gradient that starts here and grows on this direction, and it's growing all along this direction. So you see that it's bluish and then goes reddish. Bluish, and then it goes reddish. And it's the same gradient of both sides. So what's this describing? What does it describe? Come on, it's written down here. You have a current flowing in this direction, okay? The current splits into two. The gradient here is softer than the gradient here or here, so that the sum of the currents through these arms adds up to the current that is exiting or entering the ring. Okay? You can have a different configuration, which will be of this form. Now the phase wraps around 2 pi on this circle, and the phase of this tube and the phase of this tube is constant. It's just the phase at this point or the phase at this point. So what does this describe? It's a flux quantum. It's a circular current. With only one quantum of flux around the loop. Okay, so, and like this, you can build many configurations. So it's, I hope this helps you visualize a little bit what we are going to see, if not today, then on Friday. Okay, this is for later. Bring a little bit there. I can do it. Okay. So as I told you, this is really not essential. You can find it on the web just for illustrations. Okay, but now we are going to move on to devices that really make use of this phase difference. And they built on a very simple idea, which is superconductor, insulator, superconductor junction. So you will have something like this. Superconductor, some insulator, a superconductor. And you can establish between them, for instance, voltage or intensity differences. So people did these experiments, and the first thing that you have to realize is that when you have this, the particles that move through the superconductor, they are actually forming bound pairs. So it's like a molecule. Okay? Two electrons are bound by the interaction through the medium, and in order to break this pair, you would have to break them. Okay? So if you put here a metal, right? What happens with the superconductor enters the metal? The Cooper pair cannot remain as a Cooper pair. It has to be broken down, and then it would have to tunnel. In the insulator, situation is a bit more tricky because we don't even expect those charged particles to enter the material because it's an insulator. So what can happen? In principle, this, you could expect that if this is thick enough, nothing would pass through. Okay? But if you make this thinner and thinner, what happens is that a current is established. And the only way to explain this current is by means of quantum tunneling of particles from one side to the other, because we don't have anything that really provides the Cooper pairs with the extra energy to be broken down and pass through as normal conductance in an ohmic material. So we are going to work with this using a quantum model that could be, in principle, justified using BCS theory, and this is what Josephson did. But we are going to work with it using just the typical toy model. Where we assume that the insulating barrier is modeled as simply a potential barrier, is high enough, so that particles in general wouldn't feel compelled to be inside here. But we're not looking for the ground state. We are going to look for configurations where you have some particles coming in. Some particles coming out. And the question is what happens in the middle. Okay. Because we assume that particles are moving in this direction, theta L and theta R are going to be spatially dependent. So you will have something like K times X in each of them with the appropriate K to describe the current. But we only need to know what happens on the boundaries to find out the stationary solutions of this problem. Okay. So we are looking for solutions to the equation plus over. Well, now this insulating barrier is not the electrostatic potential that we mentioned before. It's simply just this barrier. So for solving this problem, the usual approximation is to say that the vector potential is zero everywhere. We have managed to get rid of any flux, magnetic flux, around the system or inside the superconductor. So we assume that A is zero. We are going to change this assumption at the end, okay? But it's better just to solve the problem like this. And you probably have done it in a typical quantum mechanics course. And the boundary conditions are established by simply the values of the phase at these two points, which are minus A and plus A. And notice that we don't need to impose that the density of carriers be the same. So this tunneling can happen between different materials or different conditions. So outside we simply have this relation. As the phase grows linearly with the appropriate current. But between the boundaries, we have we have this. So the energy is smaller than the barrier potential, and this tells you that the solutions for this are going to be basically exponentials, decreasing and growing exponentials. You can do the math. I did not do it. I simply copied the solution from Thierry Orlando's book, which I remind you here. Foundations of applied superconductivity. And they have a very simple form when you choose the coordinates to be symmetric, like in this case. Cosinus hyperbolicus. Sinus hyperbolicus. And something that reminds you of a penetration depth, a London penetration depth, but it's something that is property of the insulator. We are not, we can write it in a microscopic fashion, but it really has no information. Okay, so it's something that has to be checked experimentally. So this is telling you that the solutions are going to look a bit like this. You have something that decreases and then increases. And the width of this and the width of this is just the psi length that you have there. Okay, now let's follow this derivation. Yeah, you have to believe me, just like I believed that I copied it correctly. But what matters are the consequences of this, not so much the shape of the functions. There is one nice property of this solution. Where is it? I didn't copy it. Okay, yes. This looks very ugly, but the fact that the density goes down seems also inconvenient, but it has a nice property, which is that actually this describes a uniform current of particles moving through the insulator. So you can compute the superfluid current. And this is simply a function of these two coefficients that we have there. So it's really, there is no discontinuity of the current. So you would have some incoming current. This current is established through the slab, through the thin material, and then it continues on. So everything is okay. And for this, so the solution that you would have here, the boundary conditions are imposed by the phases at these points and the densities at these points. So you find that this is simply some critical current, sine of theta L minus theta R. And you will first thing is that one gets pissed off by the fact that we have actually taken the difference in the opposite order, but that's because JC is minus Q H bar is of this form. And we have chosen this quantity to be positive. You remember that the carriers are Cooper pairs, so Q is minus 2A. So we have chosen this to be larger or equal to 0. Okay, so current is moving there, and it depends on the phase difference on this direction. This sounds familiar, no? Like we saw the other day that when you have an electrical element, you would have, because of our conventions of positively charged carriers for currents, we have this notion that an inductive element establishes a current in this direction, but the time derivative of I causes a voltage drop. So this, the voltage is larger here than here. Because of what we saw before, theta is related to the voltage. So what we have here is a relation between intensity and voltage, similar to the one that we would expect for other elements. Okay, so that was a bit fast, but I hope more or less you get the idea of how this works. Okay? As usual, you may interrupt me at any point, and whatever crosses your mind. Okay, now at this point is where we simply take for granted that there is exists another solution using the vector potential. I'm going to tell you how it looks like. It's just this. So it's going to look like this. The current is proportional to some critical value, which is the same one. A sign of a phase difference. And this phase difference is of this form. So you have included the vector potential into the phase, creating what is called a gauge invariant phase. And this will account for any possible additional vector potentials that you can have around here. Okay, this is, can be important. It's going to be important when we have loops, where there's going to be some flux moving around it. Or when you have time dependence of these guys, you may have that the phase depends on the voltage and things like that. Okay, so that's a definition. I mean, it's simply that we take the Schrodinger equation and solve it now, including the possibility that you have A. Nothing else changes. But this hints the introduction of a different physical quantity, which is this gauge invariant phase, which we can define at any point in the superconductor. Okay? So it's going to be useful because if you can define it all over the superconductor and you cut the superconductor at some point, you can know what is the current the current that is created by barriers at those points. Okay? So it's convenient to move from the phase of the wave function to this other quantity that is going to show up again and again, which satisfies the properties, the nice properties that this guy only satisfies in an approximate way. So I'm going to remove this. This is it. Like this. Now we can take the time derivative of this phase. And you remember that we wrote expressions for the time derivative of the phase. You find them in the notes. But basically, there was a part that goes like the currents. this is going to be zero because we already saw that current is really continuous along the material. There is a part that comes from the electromagnetic potential. And it contains also now this. This additional contribution. And well, more or less you see the pattern. So we have on the same level, and the electrostatic potential and the vector potential. So at the end, what you come out with is that the time derivative of this phase is 2 pi over phi 0, the integral of the electric potential along the circuit, which is proportional to the voltage difference VR minus R. And this is what we are going to use again and again. So what we are going to use for our circuits is that we will have our junction established between two points. This will be the symbol for the junction. We will have some flux value here and a flux value here. We will assume that the current moves in that direction. And we will say that the intensity is going to be the critical intensity that can pass through the junction. And we have 2 pi over phi 0 phi L minus phi R. Okay, so that's our constituent equation, which is very similar to the one that you have for an inductor, where you had that this is equal to 1 over L phi R. So if you assume that you have very small flux differences, you can linearize, and you can find that there is a kind of effective inductance on this guy. So you have this curve, and around zero, this behaves like 1 over L junction over times the phase difference. So, in other words, we have found an element that is nonlinear in its behavior, where the established current is a sinusoidal function of the voltage difference. Okay? It's nonlinear. We are going to use the nonlinearity again and again. But if we have weakly varying currents, we can work with this element as if it was linear, with a very powerful inductance. Okay? And we are also going to use it again and again.
So for the injection, here you have the flux variables, because you are assuming that there could be an external potential, vector potential. Otherwise, this would the flux variables would just be the superconducting phases.
Yes. Yes. But we can do it now. We can do it after the break. What comes now is that now you define this gauge invariant phase in general, and forget about the real phase, and work with this guy. And this is the phase that gives you the current. This is the phase that is gives you the flux quantization, and this is the phase that is basically proportional to the flux variable, understood as an electric variable, not as okay. And we need that. We already have here more or less hinted how it works. But maybe we can do the break now and we can go back to this with more detail after that, if you want. So please ask questions, because this is somehow one critical part of the understanding these circuits. Is all clear? Okay, let's make a break here. Okay. We can pause this camera. Where is it? Yes, we recall again that there was this fluxoid quantization relation that arises from the fact that the current was proportional to the gradient of the phase and the vector potential. Okay. Now we are going to do something slightly different. We are going to assume that we are in a superconductor, whatever shape it has. It can have holes, it can have, can be simply connected or whatever, but we start with a reference point, zero, and we define paths that go to other points, P or X in general. And we will define the phase, the gauge invariant phase on each point, moving through different paths. It's going to be really path independent, in a way that we can then analyze what happens, for instance, when we run around the circle, or when we have a more sophisticated circuit, which will be with lots of tubes, junctions, capacitors, inductors, and things like that. The idea is that phi x minus phi 0 is the integral of the gradient of this phase along this loop, or path in this case, an open path. This is going to be the integral of the phase of the superconductor along this path minus 2 pi phi 0, and then it's this is run with the opposite sign because of what we saw before. And it's simply just a definition. Our analogy now is that we will make this relate to the flux on the circuit, where you had that flux is the derivative of the potential differences that appear there. So we simply add the plus quantum here at the front. Add the plus quantum here. And this goes. And that will be just this path. Always around paths, okay? So this is assuming what I showed you before, that this gauge invariant phase difference is going to be proportional to the voltage difference. That's something that can be seen more in general by simply substituting the definition of phi. But what this tells you is that if I now take a closed loop around these guys, I mean, you take a loop that starts in one point and ends on the same point, so we have this integral in a circle or some other closed loop, integral another closed loop, integral another closed loop, so that the integral of the different flux differences along the path. It's going to be a quantity that is essentially a multiple of the flux quantum, and this, which is just the externally induced flux in the loop. Okay. So that is really the last thing that we need to quantize circuits. So we have that. We have three possible circuit elements that we can build. One is going to be a capacitor. Transport is derivative. The other one is going to be an inductor, where now is voltage. The last one is the Josephson junction. Where now the current is a difference of voltages. And the last thing that we have to impose is that we have fluxoid quantization, which is that the integral around the closed path of the gradient of the electric flux is just the external flux plus some multiple of the flux quantum. Okay. And that's all we need. So knowing this, we can start understanding the dynamics. Can you read everything? Okay. Understanding the dynamics of any circuit that you can possibly conceive combining linear and nonlinear elements. And we didn't need to impose these rules a priori. They simply appear by looking at each element individually and now taking them all into consideration simultaneously. Is it? So these are basically constituent equations for the circuit elements that we find in our device. And this is like a constraint that decreases the number of degree of freedoms that we have in our circuit. Because what this is telling you is that if you make some loop like this, with some circuit elements, you could in principle have a flux difference here, a flux difference here, a flux difference here, and a flux difference here. And if you were to think classically, you would say, okay, the flux here has to be the same if I start here or if I go around the loop. So they would add up to zero. Okay. Well, this would say that at least, for instance, one of them could be explained in terms of linear combination of the others. What this quantization rule tells you is that this is not exactly like that. The sum over fluxes over a loop can be some non-zero contribution. It can be an external flux, or it can be a trapped flux that is in your system. And that's because we can, as we have seen before, establish phase rotations that are eigenstates of our problem, and they stay there for as long as the superconductor allows, provided that you don't have too much dissipation or interaction with the environment. So these are constituent equations, and this is just a constraint on the number of independent variables that we have in our circuit, which is different from the one that you would have for an ordinary circuit, non-superconducting. So what we can do now is that we can start basically where Michel de Bourdelle's note starts, which is to write down a set of rules for going from a circuit to a Hamiltonian with a minimal number of independent variables. And this is circuit quantization theory proper. I mean, it's just what you would do when faced with any circuit. It consists on a number of rules. I have to fix my notes because the lecture notes that are on the web have some serious typos regarding signs and so on. I will try to be more clear here. The idea would be the following. I'm going to write down a circuit that we are going to use later on, but this is true for any circuit. So you have some electrical circuit, you have some constituent elements like capacitor, an inductor, and another capacitor, and a voltage source. And the first thing that you do is you see this as a graph. You're going to see this circuit as a graph. And you're going to draw an open graph. So it's a subtree. It's not a full graph, just a subtree that runs over all intersections once. Okay, so we are going to label the intersections here. This is will be 0, this will be A, and there will be another one here, B. And you are completely free to choose whatever graph you want. The outcome shouldn't depend on that, just because of what we saw before. The integrals that I defined before don't depend on the path of integration, provided you don't have singularities. But for instance, I can choose this guy. Okay, well, this. And now here, one thing that is very relevant. This is connected to ground. This is connected to ground. So this point and this point, they are the same. Okay? That's something you have to keep in mind. These are going to be points that are always on the same voltage, so to say. You can see it as coming here. So it's there is no independent degree of freedom there because it's going to ground. Voltage is your reference, 0. And so you see that this is very easy in this case. You have just one dimensional path which covers 1, 2, and 3 intersections. And the next thing that you do is you define node flux variables on each intersection on this tree. So for this particular example, I can be as general as possible and have a flux variable phi 0, phi a, and phi b, and they are supposed to be independent in principle. Okay, so I'm not going to impose any constraint at this point. Okay. Now, there is a tricky part. Now is that you have to choose directions. Yeah, you now have to take this tree and choose directions. Those directions can be associated to the intensities that you're going to define or to the voltages. You just have to be consistent with yourself. I'm going to use the conventions I have on my notes for later. And I'm going to introduce uh, this direction for a current, another one for this current, and I chose this one for this other current. Okay. So you go from a tree to a directive. I don't know if this is the term, but you are adding some additional information. And the reason why we need this is what I told you before. We have now to write down the constituent equations for those elements. So we have to make use of the relations for capacitors, inductors, and so on. And you remember that those relations depend, so this is the intensity directions. Intensity. Those relations depend on the voltage differences. So it relates intensity to flux differences. Okay? So what I'm going to do next is to define branch fluxes. The full graph. Okay, so I would have this, I'm going to use blue. I'm going to have this one here will be I'm going to have also this one. Notice that we go this with this convention that the flux difference goes the other way. This is not like that, okay. We don't know what this quantity is. We have also from here to there. And I think there is no other one, okay? So notice that I only define these flux differences on the tree. And when I'm not on the tree, we have that those flux differences are not going to be independent from the other fluxes. Okay, so it's a very tricky notion, but this comes from the fact that, as we saw before, whenever you have a loop, you have flux quantization, so this flux difference can be expressed in terms of this flux difference. So I introduce all branch fluxes. Difference of fluxes along different paths. This is the change of energy of a particle, basically. But only those which belong to this open tree are going to be independent, and the other ones are going to be expressed in terms of this one. Okay, and now we
choice of writing delta phi a zero as phi a minus phi zero is because we choose the current to go.
Flux difference. These are the branch flux is an oriented idea. Okay, because it's difference, you have to know along which direction you are taking the difference. Okay, mm-hmm. So you have to keep it in mind. I'm just trying to be consistent with myself. So you can choose any orientation.
But in this sense, this depends on how I choose this current, this green arrow, right?
Not necessarily.
I can also.
You could do it the other way.
You could. But I can also write the current like that and then define phi zero minus phi eight.
The other way, yeah.
But
I do it like this because now, after another step, I'm going to write down the equations for the inductors and capacitors, and if my branch fluxes are defined in the opposite sense of currents, it's going to be easier for me to find the relations between them. Okay, but you can do it in general. Okay, doesn't matter. Because now the things that are comfortable now is that if I choose orientation right, you cannot always do it when you have loops, but in this case it's very comfortable. You have to use looks like quantization. To write the dependent flux differences. In terms of the differences on the tree. And this is done simply by looking at how many loops you have and writing the quantization of the flux on each of them. So in this very stupid circuit, I only have one loop. Okay, it would be this one. So I could have here some external flux trapped. And in principle, I would have to write that. Yeah, okay, you could have the other one.
Yeah, I see three. No?
I see only two. Two independent ones.
But how do you define it? I mean, I could go through the whole circuit by the capacitor?
Yeah, but you have only... So that's true. This is not going to be a variable, okay? This is going to be a fixed quantity. In principle, I could add it. I could add here delta phi. This will be 0 b. Which comes from this voltage, okay? Now, if you realize this, you have two independent variables and two dependent ones. So you only need two equations to extract these guys. So that means you only need to find two loops in this circuit. One would be this one, and the other one would be this one, or would be this one. It's up to you. But you cannot have more equations, but you can have more equations, but you will find that they are actually, you will have that they are redundant. Yes, I forgot that. But, okay. I forgot that. It's just out of use. V is going to be, it's not going to be a variable in my circuit, it's going to be a constant. So that's why I didn't include it in this picture. So but basically, this applies to all loops. You would have that in this case, for this example, A0. Plus 0a and because we don't have a closed loop, we are going to assume that this is 0. That's a typical assumption for AC circuits. Which means that simply this is what we expected, that delta in this case is going to be phi 0 minus phi a. But in general, you can find more complicated situations. Okay?
So we can take this 0 because we have the capacitor that breaks this.
In general, you can have trapped fluxes in your circuits. This happens especially when you have loops where you can establish a current through it. I would think that for these LC circuits with a broken capacitor, the only currents that you can have are AC currents. The capacitor doesn't allow a static flow of current, okay. So I don't think that you could establish it in this case. But you could have an external flux from a magnetic field. Mm-hmm. In principle, you could have it. So, but in general, the typical assumption that we make is this is only going to be relevant when you have loops with junctions and inductors and things like that. I must say that when flux gets trapped and so on is still something that is not so intuitive for me, because it really depends on experimental details, how you cool down the system and things like that. But that was a problem, for instance, in the first experiments with Josephson junction arrays. I have to erase because I don't have space, and we only have room for one blackboard in the camera. But assuming that you now have all your variables right, you simply have to make use of the constituent equations. And you can derive all the intensities that move through the circuit based on these flux differences. Okay. Just for completeness, you have an element which can be anything. For a capacitor, you will have that the current is this, where, as I told you before, I have chosen this sense for the intensity and this sense for the flux difference. For the inductor, you have so this is a second time derivative, this is the first time, no, this is just without derivative. And for the junction, this is a junction, you have this. Nonlinear relation that I wrote before. You can also put here the critical current. And in the end, we are going to forget about these quantities and we are going to use energy. So that's not bad. So, and okay, the last step is that, well, the last, first to last step is to find out all differential equations by posing that the sum of currents on a node is zero. So you have that the sum of currents that sink or leave a node has to be zero, because, I mean, you cannot create charge out of anything. So in this case, for instance, it's clear that the current that goes through this leg has to be the difference between this current and this current, so that at the end there is a net flow in this direction, and it doesn't disappear or create, is created from nowhere. And this is going to lead to differential equations that have a more or less clear form. Is they are of this form. So thank you. Typically, you will have things like phi zero L. So the most general shape that it will take is some matrix multiplying second order derivatives of the fluxes. Has to be, these are the currents that go into the capacitors, has to equate the currents that come from the inductors. And you will have a linear term that is the inverse of some inductive matrix. And also the nonlinear part coming from the junctions themselves. And what you can always do is that you can always find the Lagrangian. This is the last step. Yes?
Sorry, what's the index of the first term in those equations?
Sorry, yes. I just wanted to make the difference so this is J, this is K, because they are not related, okay?
Okay.
This will be one matrix times a vector of variables, of flux variables, another matrix times another vector, and then a sum of terms that depends on certain flux differences. And so you can always bring this into Lagrangian such that this equation can be written as in this form. Okay. You can always do it. In the end, you will find that it's relatively straightforward. You don't even need to do all this thinking. You can write it directly almost. And what this tells you is that when you do this and then you quantize, introducing the charges and imposing that they are canonically conjugate variables, the shape of the Hamiltonians is always going to look very similar. It's going to be some vector of charges, the inverse of some capacitance matrix, things like this. This is going to have a very recurrent form. So you will have a capacitive energy that goes like the inverse of the capacitance matrix. You will have some inductive energy, which is linear. This is linear. This is what gives rise to your LC oscillator. And then you have some nonlinear part, which is the one that we are used to define qubits and things like that. But it's again and again always the same shape. Consistency checks, so you have to check that this is upper bounded, so this never goes to minus infinity. So this is somehow obvious in this part, but it's not so obvious when you write the circuit, so make sure that you don't write something that diverges. And that would be your starting point for really doing quantum mechanics with whatever circuit you think of. Okay, so it's a lot of steps, but in the end you can automate them very quickly and then forget about how you follow them. Is it more?
Yeah, what do you mean about that you can automate it very directly?
So well, you have a
given a circuit, you don't have to follow the machinery.
You can most of the time you can write down what is the capacitance matrix, because it's the capacitance between nearest neighbors, and you can write this matrix. The same for the inductance, and this is will be the terms that are more tricky to write down, because in principle here you can have also variables which are external fluxes, okay, inside, and that's the only place where you really have to look at the loops and see how it goes.
Because the
the black variables that you choose do depend on which tree are you considering?
No, the node fluxes, they don't depend. The branch fluxes, they depend on your choices. But this is only manifested in the junctions, okay? But in the end, because the cosine is symmetric, it really doesn't matter which sense you chose for that part, okay? You simply have to be consistent with yourself. So that's why I said at the beginning of this course that it's very easy to get results in a very lousy way. And really to do things carefully, it's a bit more tricky. But you can write a model just by looking at the circuit and thinking a little bit about it. Okay, so we're going to do that guy, and a different guy, because they are the prototypical examples that we will then convert into qubits. Okay, we start with an LC oscillator, which we saw the other day that gives you a harmonic potential. This is the flux. And it has some kinetic energy, which is like a kinetic energy of a particle. It's p squared 2m. But this was harmonic. But I told you that we are going to make it unharmonic. But we're going to basically start from this design. Yeah? We start from this design and we'll make it unharmonic. What is very useful is that if we can quantize this guy, then we can see also how the qubit is driven. So this describes an LC oscillator coupled to external source of potential. Okay, now I have to be consistent with myself. Uriel was right that in principle we would have to include this flux difference, but I'm going to assume that this is given by the voltage source, that whatever generator I have for that. And if I do my math, according to the previous rules, you find that there is only one and two independent branch variables. This one is expressed in terms of these ones, as I said before. So that is solved. And now what they have to do is to add up intensities. This is going to be the intensity due to the voltage source, the intensity of the capacitor, and the intensity of the inductor. So we have that. This form. Or if you want, well, it's going to be useful to keep it like this. We have two capacitances, one here and one here. This is going to be my gate voltage. That's when I realized I took the other convention in my notes, but anyway, we continue with this. So this guy is simply C. This guy is simply this. And this guy because of what I said before, okay? So this pops up here. So we have three equations. We take the difference between them. And I'm going to use that there is no trap fluxes. I'm going to use that this circuit is grounded. I can take this constant to be zero. It's just the integral of the potential at the ground point. And I'm going to use also that I have an external voltage source, which well, depends on how you define it, but it's given by this equation, which is like this. Okay? So this goes away, this goes away, this goes away, and I'm only left with one quantity that is independent.
Could be time dependent.
I'm not going to impose anything. I'm just finding out differential equations, and at this point, I don't impose anything. I simply use this idea, so that the equation that I get is just the one you had already. Minus Cj minus 5, which should be this one. So this is, it's not easy, not difficult to realize this. You can take C plus Cj as a common factor. Something like this. Okay, you see it, more or less? So this is telling me that the capacitance of my LC circuit has changed because I am coupled to the external circuit. You remember that the other day we did the oscillator, this was just C, and this was absent. So now I'm going to see a renormalization of the frequency of my circuit due to the external driving. And the total Lagrangian that you need for describing this circuit is of this form. Just like this. Okay. So it's the form I anticipated before, basically, with some linear sources in this case that were not present before. So it's not different from an oscillator that we had before. But notice that if I now compute the canonically conjugate variable to the flux, which is this guy, this is going to be C sigma Cj Vg. Okay, so you have to be careful with these things when you invert this to get a Hamiltonian. Now I have to express phi a dot in terms of the independent variables that are going to be Q and Vj, and I compute the Hamiltonian as Q phi dot minus the Lagrangian, so that my final result is sigma, what is good? Pi square. Yeah, I dropped the index. So, nothing too sophisticated, simply that the external voltage is shifting the origin of the charge. Okay? So, before we had some equilibrium value in a classical sense that was Q equals zero. Now it has been shifted. You can see this as minus Q ground state, so to say. And that's induced by the external force that induces some accumulation of charges in the capacitor at equilibrium. Okay. And this idea is going to be used when we go to the nonlinear regime for qubits.
Here there would be also an algorithm driving over cavity, no?
Yeah, so if you now quantize this Hamiltonian, you can express phi and q in terms of, no, I haven't written it down, but basically you can find again phi h bar set to a plus a daga, q h bar to set I a daga minus a. And then you will find that H is equal to the LC oscillator plus some coupling, which in this case it will be with the charge. So there's going to be some coupling constant, A daga minus A phi square root of 2. And you can find the coupling strength, and this in general can be time dependent driving. So basically, it's all the things that you need for a cavity that we are going to use later on, okay? But you can do it by yourself. And just for your own illustration, I suggest that you do the same thing, but now you put here a current source and think about it. So this is going to be, you have a current here going through this oscillator, and repeat the calculation. We can stop here because the next thing that we have to do is transmission lines, which is slightly different from what is here. Let's print it. Okay. And I will put you the problems on Friday so that you have a weekend to do them if you want. You asked me what to do with the problems I'm sending you. Just write them on a paper, put your name, and give it to me. I can correct them and give them back to you. But the first one was just for your own illustration. I will start with that on Friday. I will give you the first one on secret quantization, and then we will move on through that, okay? And that's it. We're finished. Enough.